नमो भगवते
वासुदेवाय।
ओम नमो भगवते
वासुदेवाय।
ओम नमो भगवते
वासुदेवाय।
श्रीमद् भागवतम फोर्थ कैंटो चैप्टर 12। ध्रुव महाराज गोज बैक टू गॉड हेड। टेक्स्ट 24। तस्याखिल जगत धातुर आवाम देवस्य शांगिनः पार्षदा इह संप्राप्तो नेतुं त्वां भगवत् पदम्। तस्याखिल जगद्धातुर् आवाम देवस्य सांगिनः पार्षदा विह संप्राप्तो नेतुं त्वं भगवत् पदम्। तस्याखिल जगद्धातुर् आवाम देवस्य सांगिनः पार्षदा विह संप्राप्तो नेतुं त्वां भगवत् पदम्। तस्याखिल जगद्धातु आवाम देवस्य शांगिनः पार्षदा विह संप्राप्तो नेतुं त्वं भगवत् पदम्।
तस्याखिल
जगद्धातु
आवां देवस्य
शान्तिनः
पार्षदा विह संप्राप्तौ
Mataji's.
Tasya khila jagadhatu
avam devasya sanginah
avam devasya sanginah
Tasya, his, Akhila, entire, Jagat, universe, Dhatu, creator, Avam, we, Devasya, of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Shanginaha, who has the bow name Shanga, Parshadau, associates, Iha, now, Sampraptau, approached, Netum, to take, Tvam, you, Bhagavat Padam, to the position of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Translation by His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada. We are representatives of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the creator of the whole universe, who carries in his hand the bow named Shanga. We have been specifically deputed to take you to the spiritual world. Please repeat after me. We are representatives of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The creator of the whole universe,
who carries in his hand
the bow named Shanga. We have been specifically deputed to take you to the spiritual world. Purport by Srila Prabhupada. In Bhagavad Gita, the Lord says that simply by knowing His transcendental pastimes, whether within this material world or in the spiritual world, anyone who understands factually who He is, how He appears and how He acts can be immediately fit for transfer to the spiritual world. This principle stated in the Bhagavad Gita operated in the case of King Dhruva. Throughout his life, he tried to understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead by austerity and penances. Now the mature result was that Dhruva Maharaj became fit to be carried to the spiritual world, accompanied by the confidential associates of the Lord. Tassa khila jagat dhatur avam devasya sanginah parshadav iha samprapto netum tvam bhagavat padam. We are representatives of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the creator of the whole universe, who carries in his hand the bow named Sangha, and we have been specifically deputed to take you to the spiritual world. So, Dhruva Maharaj goes back to Godhead. In previous five chapters, Dhruva Maharaj's activities have been so wonderfully described. Dhruva Maharaj, at the age of 5, when he was insulted by his stepmother, he left home and went to the forest. There he was searching, according to his mother's instruction, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. When he went back to his mother crying that he was not allowed by his stepmother to sit on his father's lap, Dhruva was very insulted. And his mother felt very helpless. She told him, look, this is our situation, what can be done? The only person who can actually rectify this situation, the only person who can fulfill your desire is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Hari. So Dhruva asked, where can I find Hari? The mother replied, when somebody wants to look for, goes out to search for Hari, goes to the forest. So Hari is in the forest. So Dhruva just left home, 5-year-old child, left home, went to the forest. And he started to look for Hari. The forest was full of wild animals. Where was his search first? He saw the animals and he asked, are you Hari? Whoever he was seeing, he was asking whether he was Hari. And all those ferocious animals did not harm Dhruva Maharaj, this little child, because his search was so sincere that the Lord situated in the hearts of those animals, ferocious animals, became or did not become antagonistic to him, did not attack him, didn't harm him. Then Narad Muni took pity upon Dhruva. He saw that this boy is searching for the Lord in such a sincere way. So Narad Muni decided to help him. So this way we can see that when one's search is sincere, then the spiritual master appears. Narad Muni is the spiritual master. The Lord sends his representative like Narad Muni. And that this we have seen happen in the life of many of us when we are searching for a bona fide spiritual master, when we are searching for spiritual life. Krishna sent the spiritual master. I was searching for a guru in India and I couldn't find any. I couldn't find any in the sense I couldn't find anyone to whom I could completely surrender myself to. I didn't know at that time what to expect from a guru. But one thing I knew that I have to surrender to the spiritual master. But I couldn't find anybody to whom I could surrender. And then I gave up my search. I said, if I have a guru, let him come and pick me up. I have been searching for him and I can't find him. And then very mercifully, Krishna sent Srila Prabhupada. So, and what does a bona fide spiritual master do? What is the qualification of a spiritual master? As we are seeing in this case here. Narad Muni came and he told him that, look, if you want to find Hari, this is the way. This is the mantra. You chant this mantra, meditate on this mantra, and the Supreme Personality of Godhead will appear. And Dhruva again took the instruction of his spiritual master so seriously that he practically stopped eating, stopped drinking, and finally stopped breathing. A five-year-old boy. Such sincerity. Just completely absorbed in meditating on the mantra. Completely absorbed. So much so that he lost any interest for any material activities, even to the extent of eating and sleeping. So this is important. The process is there and the process must be practiced properly. And the Supreme Personality of Godhead appeared and bestowed his mercy upon him. Dhruva was just a five-year-old boy. But just by seeing the Lord, he became enlightened. He achieved his spiritual perfection. And then the Lord blessed him. Dhruva, your desire will be fulfilled. Dhruva said, no, I don't want this material desire to be fulfilled now. I was out of my ignorance, out of my lack of understanding. I wanted to become the king. I wanted to have a kingdom even greater than my grandfather's. But I don't want that now. Because now that I have seen you, I have realized this material possessions, material situations are completely irrelevant. Completely insignificant. He said, I was actually looking for some broken pieces of glass. And now that I have found the diamond, why should I be interested in these broken pieces of glass? So, but the Lord said, no. You do that. You go ahead. Rule your kingdom. And then we saw how wonderfully Dhruva Maharaj ruled his kingdom. And then at some point Dhruva Maharaj decided to retire. Because materialistic life should not be pursued forever. There should be an end to it. When one is young, one wants to enjoy. So, okay, fine, enjoy. But the enjoyment should not be the goal of life. Enjoyment in this material nature through sense gratification should never be the goal of life. The goal of life should be achieve spiritual perfection. And material enjoyment is actually a hindrance to that. The more we become absorbed in sense gratification, the more we become oblivious about the spiritual purpose, spiritual objective. So Dhruva Maharaj retired from home. And he went to Badarikashram. There he was spending his time in the association of saintly personalities, exalted sages. Those who were residing there, Dhruva Maharaj was spending his time in their association. And then we are coming to this point. One day, a chariot arrived there from the spiritual sky. There were two personalities there who looked exactly like Narayan. They had four arms. In those four arms, they were carrying conch, lotus, disc, and mess. And their bodily complexion was just like monsoon cloud, bluish as monsoon cloud. Eyes were beautiful, like fully bloomed lotuses. So these personalities came, and now they're introducing themselves to Dhruva Maharaj. The previous verse described, they're introducing themselves as Nanda and Sunanda, two very, very important associates of the Lord. Narayan's two very intimate associates are Nanda and Sunanda. And they told him that we are the, now they're explaining, I mean expressing to him, that we are the two associates of the Lord. We are his representatives, we have been assigned, we have been deputed to take you back to the spiritual sky. So this way, Dhruva Maharaj is now ready to go back to the spiritual sky. The process, this is an indication that the process works. What Krishna said in Bhagavad Gita, Prabhupada is pointing out in the purport, if one practices the process, as Krishna has instructed in Bhagavad Gita, as Krishna has expressed in Bhagavad Gita, what is the process that Prabhupada is mentioning here? Janma karma chame dibhyam evam javetti tattvatah tvakta dehaṁ punarjanma naiti mameti so arjuna. Janma karma chame dibhyam. When one understands, Krishna himself is telling, that when one understands that his birth, janma and karma, his activities, are divyam, divine. Those who know that Krishna's birth and Krishna's activities are divine, divyam. Evam javetti tattvara. When one knows that, knows it in factually, in truth. Anyone who understands factually who he is, who he is, how he appears, and how he acts, can immediately be fit for transfer to the spiritual world. Evam javitakta dehaṁ punarjanma naiti mameti suvarjana. Dhruva Maharaj's time has come to leave his body. But where is he going? He is going to a place, jad gatvāna nivartante stadhāma paramam. going there, no one comes back to this material world once again. Ajopi san abhayatma. Prior to that, Krishna explained that ajopi san abhayatma. Before that, what did Krishna say? Krishna told Arjuna, bohuni me vyatitani janmani tapacharjuna. Many, many times, Arjuna, you have taken birth, so did I. But you don't remember anything about your previous births, whereas I remember everything. Janmani tava charjuna tani ahang beda sarvani. I know about those births, sarvani, incomplete. But natang betha parantapa, but you do not. And then Krishna is saying, ajopi san abhayatma bhutanam isharopi san. Although I am unborn, aja, abhayatma, inexhaustible, bhutanam isharopi san, controller of all the living entities, but prakritiṃ samadhiṣṭhāya sambhavāmi ātma māyāya. Taking advantage of my prakriti. Prakriti means my spiritual nature, yoga-māyā. Sambhavāmi, not birth, not janmāmi, but sambhavāmi. I manifest myself. Krishna also mentions afterwards, sambhavāmi yuge yuge. Sambhavāmi, here also he is saying, sambhavāmi ātma māyāya. And then he is saying, that when one understands that my birth and my activities are divine, janma karma chame divyam evam javetti tattvatah takta deham punarjanma naiti mameti shuarjana, which actually means when one understands that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Krishna is not an human being. Krishna is not an ordinary living entity. Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And that also Krishna has reminded the living entities, that how he is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. But unfortunately, less intelligent people, abhajananti mang mudha manushim tanumashritam. Mudhas means fools. Fools abhajananti deride me because I appeared in a human-like form. Manushim tanumashritam. But param bhava majananto mamobhuto maheshwaram. But they do not know, they do not ajananta, they do not know my param bhavam, my transcendental nature. Krishna may appear to be like a human being, but look at his activities. Which human being can ever do that? Like sometimes somebody came and told that his guru is Bhagavan. Then Prabhupada said, okay, if your guru is Bhagavan, then I have a challenge for him. Ask him to lift a table and hold it for 7 minutes on his little finger. So he went and told that person. And his person's reply was, how is it possible? And this person was intelligent, so he left him. He rejected that guru and took shelter of Prabhupada. And Prabhupada's point was, Krishna held the Govardhan hill on his little finger for 7 days. Now if somebody says that he is God, then at least let him lift a table and hold it for 7 minutes on his little finger. So that is divyam. Janma karma chame divyam. Karma, his activities are divine. Param bhavam ajananto. Param bhavam, his transcendental nature. At the age, when he was 7 days old, he swallowed the most deadly poison called Kalkut. Putana came smearing her breast with this deadly poison, intending to kill Krishna. But what did Krishna do? Not only he digested the deadliest poison, but sucked the life air out of her body by just sucking her breast. So this is how Krishna acts, 7 days old. And then what to speak of the other activities, killing terrible demons like Agasura, Bakasura, Trinavartasura, Arishtasura, Keshi, Bomasura, lifting Govardhan, subduing Kaliya. Who can ever do things like that? Therefore, it is so important that we hear about Krishna's activities from a reliable source, from a bona fide source. Because when we hear about Krishna from a bona fide source, meaning those who know Krishna as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, when we hear about Krishna from them, then we get to know Krishna also. Therefore, hearing is so important. Hearing, also reading is another kind of hearing. Reading also is hearing. When you read, you are hearing. You are hearing the author. When you read Bhagavad Gita, you are hearing Krishna directly from him. When you read Prabhupada's purports, you are hearing directly from Srila Prabhupada. In this way, these personalities bestow their mercy in the form of printed words. So in this way, we get to know Krishna. And when we get to know, as we said, janma karma chame dibhyam evam javetti tattvataha, tattvataha, factually, then takta deham, when they leave their body, punar janma, they don't have to take birth again. Why they don't take birth again? Because they are transported to the spiritual sky. And the spiritual sky is jat gatvana nivartante. When one goes there, he doesn't want to come back here. Who wants to come back to the world of suffering when you have reached the world of joy? When you have seen the world of joy, when you have been elevated to the world of joy, why will you come back to the world of suffering? And especially when you reach there after so much endeavor, why do you want to come back? Why do you want to come back? Therefore, the goal of human life is to finish off all business here and go back to Krishna. And that is possible simply by developing our attachment to Krishna. So ultimately, it's a matter of attachment. Where should we have our attachment? Attachment to wife and children? Bad luck. Be careful not to develop that attachment. Because then the chances are there that you have to come back again. On the other hand, if you develop your attachment to Krishna, then what happens? Develop your attachment to Krishna, then you will go back to Krishna. So ultimately, antakale chamameva smaran mukta kalevaram ja prayati samad bhavam jati nastatra sangsaya. Antakale chamameva, when one leaves his body, antakale, at the time of death, when one remembers Krishna, chamameva smaran mukta kalevaram, leaves his body remembering Krishna, he goes back to Krishna's transcendental nature. Madbhavam sa prayati jat prayati samadbhavam nasti jati nastatra samsaya. Thank you. So that is Krishna's promise. You remember Krishna so much, you develop the attachment so much, that you remember Krishna at that very, very difficult time when you are leaving the body. And it won't be difficult if you practice properly, as we are saying, as we are seeing. Is it difficult for Dhruva Maharaj to remember Krishna? The Vishnu Dutas came to take him. So how can you forget? The Vishnu Dutas come and they say, look, we have come to take you to Krishna. Who will you think at that time? Some unfortunate soul may think, oh, I have some business to finish in the material world. Please allow me to stay for a little longer. How can I leave my body? How can I leave now my wife and children? What will happen to them? Let us not victims of such misfortune. To remember Krishna, remember anyone other than Krishna at the time of death. That's why this practice throughout the life, like as Dhruva Prabhupada is pointing out, as Dhruva Maharaj did, throughout his life he just tried to cultivate the process of remembering Krishna. So you all also do that. Use your time to remember Krishna throughout your life. Get up in the morning, go to Mangala Arati to have the darshan of Krishna. Throughout the day, cultivate your Krishna consciousness. And if you can't remember Krishna, at least at the time of prasadam, remember Krishna varadayamoy, koribare jivajoy, sha prasadanda dilabhai. So this is why ashram life is so important. At every step, you remember Krishna. Whatever you do, you're doing it for Krishna. Jat karosi, jat asnasi, jat juhasi, tad asya. Yes, very good. Okay, Mr. Manager. Yeah, recite the verse. Jat karosi. Jat tapashyoshi kunte tat kurushi. Very good. Thank you. So this is a simple process. Whatever you do, whatever you eat, whatever you give in charity, whatever austerities you perform, do it for Krishna. Offer it to Krishna. Offer the results to Krishna. Tat kurusha mad arpanam. Mad arpanam, offer it to me. And the result will be there. The result will be in such a wonderful way that we cannot even imagine. Thank you all very much. Hare Krishna. So today I have to leave. And today I have to go to Bombay. Then I have to go to Mayapur. After 2 days, tomorrow and day after tomorrow, I have some meetings in Bombay. The day after that, we have to go to Mayapur because a seminar is there. About 1,000 Bhakti Briksha members are coming to Mayapur. So that's why I'm just going there, because they are requesting me to come to be with them. And so then 25th, 26th, 27th, I'll be in Mayapur. Then 28th, again I'll come back here. Then I'll probably stay for 6 days. And then again I have to leave on the 4th or 5th, depending on Mukunda here. 5th Mukunda? When is the flight? 5th. Okay. So 5th I'll leave, and then I will, anyway, let us see. Oh no, I'll come back. Then I was thinking that of telling that, then I won't come for a long time. No, I'll come back on the 22nd for the Nityananda Trayodashi. And then again I have to go back to Mayapur for the GBC meeting. And then I'll come back after before, just before Gaur Purnima, and then for Gaur Purnima I'll go to South Africa. This year, for, I won't be in India for Gaur Purnima. Generally, I stay in India, either Mayapur or Ujjain for Gaur Purnima. But this year, I have to be in South Africa because there is a 20th anniversary of South African Rath Yatra in Durban. So, I have to be there. That is on 29th. Easter, during the Easter holiday. But 27th is Gaur Purnima, so I have to be there for Gaur Purnima. Otherwise, I have to travel on the day of Gaur Purnima to be there for that festival. Anyway, very happy to be with you all. I had a wonderful time for the last few days. A little hectic. And Radharani Devi Dasi has created quite a sensation in the internet. She posted some news saying that my health is very bad. Does it look so bad? And now I'm getting phone calls, emails from everywhere. My mistake was that I told her, let's see for how long this body lasts. And that shook her up. Yeah. That's the reality. This body is not going to last forever. Our only concern should be that this body is properly utilized to reach our next destination properly. Hare Krishna, all glories to Srila Prabhupada. So, I won't take any more questions today because I'm in a little hurry. Mr. Banerjee, thank you for coming. When did you come?
Today morning.
What time? 5 o'clock you came? Oh, okay. Oh. I'm sorry. Actually, he told me yesterday, and I told him to tell you to come at some other time when I can spend some time with you. Thank you. Hare Krishna. Does anybody have any question? Maybe I can take one or two questions.
Sent to throw Maharaj, if it came up. Now, is it the same case with everyone who goes back to God and
then? Prabhupada said, it will differ at different. For some, they may take birth in this way, I mean, leave their body in this way. There, in the scriptures, there are various instances of different ways of going back to God. Some other places it has been mentioned that one takes birth in the same planet where Krishna is performing his pastimes. Takes birth in a cowherd family. And thus he becomes qualified to go back. Sometimes some gopis are not allowed to go to Krishna, to meet Krishna. They are locked up. So they left their bodies. So that's another way of going. They left their bodies, and in their spiritual bodies, they participated in Krishna's pastimes. Then, sometimes, there had been instances like some devotees, at the time of death, they saw Prabhupada. In the sense, there is one person, one French devotee, he was a sannyasi, but after Prabhupada left, he left ISKCON. And he was leading a materialistic life, giving up spiritual life. But he was quite involved. I mean, he was a sannyasi, so he was quite advanced in his spiritual activities when Prabhupada was here. And then one day, one lady came to and met some devotees, and she asked, "Who is Prabhupada?" So these devotees explained, and their devotees asked, "Why are you asking?" Then she introduced herself that she was the wife of this devotee who left ISKCON and got married, and and she said that at the time of his death, he just said, "Prabhupada, you came," and he left his body. So she was curious. She never knew. I mean, she knew that he was a Hare Krishna at one time. Her husband was a Hare Krishna at one time, but she didn't know anything about that movement, our movement. So her husband, that sanna, that devotee, left his body saying, "Prabhupada, you came." That means who he was seeing at the time when he was leaving his body. So either Krishna can come, Krishna's devotees can come, or somebody can be transported to another world in order to enter into Krishna's pastimes directly. So many possibilities are there. Hare Krishna, Gaur Premanande, Hare Hare. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.